electric vehicles are becoming more and more prominent in a motorsport application, and there are a few considerations in order to get the best out of your EV if you are taking it to the racetrack. We're here with Jordan, owner and driver of this Model 3 Tesla behind me, to find out a little bit more about it. Jordan, before we get into the intricacies of managing a Tesla Model 3 for a track day, let's talk about the actual modifications you've made to it. What have you done?
We've done fully adjustable unplugged billet control arms. We've done spherical control arm bearings, so there's no more rubber in the suspension at all. We've taken away all the deflection. We've done a double adjustable coilover package that we're currently developing now. Adjustable sway bar. So we've basically added rigidity and added a bunch of adjustment to the vehicle to get it to do what we want it to do. So we, for the braking, we've done the APS6 big brake kit front and rear. We've done a lot of development to get the rear, the park, you know, the e-brake component put back into this system. Wheels and tires, we've got a 19 by 11 on this car, so we've got a lot of tire underneath and a lot of wheel. We're running a 305/30 R19 Falcon RT660 tire.
Is this a square setup, so front and rear the same?
Correct, yeah, we're running a square setup on the car, and you can go stagger square, you know, and adjust your balance with the shocks and with the sway bars and things like that. But we chose to run a square setup and get as much tire underneath the car as we can get underneath it.
I assume a big part of the adjustability you've added into the suspension with those arms you're talking about in terms of getting the alignment specs where you want them. I assume, like a lot of late model factory cars, little to no adjustability in the factory Tesla components.
The Tesla's even more so that way. There's basically no adjustment. You've got tow and that's it. So we're able to get anywhere from, you know, 2 degrees of negative camber all the way to over 5 degrees if we wanted it. We end up right around 3.5 degrees in the front and about 3 degrees in the rear with this setup.
Okay, let's talk a little bit about the electronic side of things in terms of getting a Tesla to perform at the racetrack. I mean, unlike an internal combustion engine, we don't fit an aftermarket ECU and sort of play with the power settings. That's not really something we do in the EV world, but there are some aspects that do need some consideration around the stability control.
Correct. Yeah, we've got what they call a bonus module, and we're actually able to go in and defeat the StabiliTrak in the car, which allows it to be much more predictable and usable on the track. From the Tesla track mode to the bonus module, we're picking up about 2 seconds a lap with that system. So it really is a huge improvement for around $600.
I assume that the factory stability control is just overbearing, and essentially any time the car starts to move around a little bit, it's trying to essentially halt any of that.
Yeah, what the Teslas do is they utilize the rear brake to try to keep the car stable. And what actually ends up happening is they apply rear brake and it wants to make the car spin out. So it creates a lot of oversteer, but it's unpredictable. So by defeating it and turning it off, we're able to drive the car and actually tune and adjust based on the mechanics of it versus it trying to think that it's doing the right thing.
Now, you mentioned that the track mode, which does retain the StabiliTrak, is there any applications where you find that that is a preferred mode to run in as opposed to the defeat?
For the autocross and the speed stop segments of this series, we do run the Tesla track mode. And that mode actually has adjustability. We can start from zero with the StabiliTrak and we can go negative 10 and we can go positive 10. So we can actually tune the way the car behaves to an extent. And then we can also adjust the front and rear bias for the all-wheel drive. So you can go, you know, 40% front, 60% rear to get the car to rotate or behave the way you want it to. And it's actually a very good system for the slow speed stuff, but on the high speed stuff, it's where, you know, the bonus module comes in.
All right, let's talk about how you manage this car at a track day. We were talking off camera before, and you mentioned you essentially have the ability to do one full pace lap, and then essentially that's it, you're calling it. Right. So you only got one shot at this, so you obviously need to make it count, but that's up to the driver. What is it about the setup that you're limiting yourself to one lap?
Well, the state of charge. So I'm trying to start at 90 to 95% state of charge, and I really don't want to end the session below 70%, because then in the hour that I have between sessions, I don't have enough time to get back to the state of charge that I want to be at for optimal performance. And what we've found between the electronics, the battery, and the tire, one lap is pretty much optimal, because after that, you know, we can equal the lap on the second lap or get, you know, within a tenth or so, but your battery degradation drops significantly, and then we're not able to get back into that optimal range for the next session. So you really just have to get out there and get it done in one lap.
So for us, those of us who maybe aren't into the EV world and don't understand this, essentially what I'm picking up from you here is if you want maximum performance from the batteries and therefore maximum power from the electric motors, you really want to have that charge up at 95%. Charge drops down, you're going to end up with essentially less power to put to the track. Is that the sort of the first element of it?
That's correct, yeah. And we find, you know, 55-50% it starts to pull power back and you start to go substantially slower. The other side of that is the battery packs get hot and the differentials get hot and then everything kind of, and it's pretty considerable. You know, at Laguna Seca up the hill from 5 to 6, I lost 40 mile an hour from lap 1 to lap 2 going up that hill just because of battery degradation and heat and all that. So
okay, so and the other element that goes hand in hand with that, as you're saying, if you've done 2 or more laps, the battery state of charge gets so low that you're not going to have enough time between your sessions to get it charged back up.
That's correct.
In terms of charging, obviously there are charging stations just about everywhere. Being a little bit more portable to take to the track, that can be a little bit trickier. How are you managing that?
So we've got 2 9,500-watt generators, and we run them in parallel. So we're effectively, you know, up around 19,000 watts, or I'm sorry, 17,000 watts, somewhere in that range. Our charging wattage is around 12,000, so, or 1,200, I'm sorry, I'm adding some zeros in here, but what that means to everybody else is I'm effectively putting as much energy back into the car as you would be able to put in a 240, 50 amp setup, like in a building. We're putting 11 back in per hour. So I can go in 1 hour, I can go from 70% state of charge up to about 90 to 95%, depending on, you know, ambient outside conditions and things like that.
Okay. In terms of the rest of the package as it sits at the moment, is there anything else that's sort of holding EVs back in terms of being able to compete at track days like this with internal combustion on an even playing field other than the charge, or is that really the main stumbling block?
It's really the battery at this point. And that technology, just like every technology, is getting better and better, you know, every year. And it's just going to exponentially get to the point where I've heard, you know, that there's going to be a point in the probably 5 to 10 year period that you don't even have to plug the car in. They're going to regen, even in track use, you know, so they're going to recapture the energy motion from the wheels and other things. I don't think solar's there yet, obviously, but you're going to see these cars at a point where you don't even have to plug them in. They're just going to generate their own energy.
I look forward to that day. You did just mention there about regen, and that sort of leads me to the regenerative braking. Now, I'm just wondering, is that something that you're making use of on the racetrack? If so, does that have any effect on the feel to the driver? Or yeah, tell us about that.
So with the bonus module that we're running, we do not use the regen currently. The regen almost feels like trail braking. So when you drive an EV on the street, you can control, you don't even have to use the brake pedal. So you can control everything through the accelerator. It's similar on the track. When you come off the accelerator, the car tries to kind of slow down. It doesn't stop, but you can, it's almost like if you're into racing and you understand what trail braking is, you can kind of come off the accelerator and create a trail brake scenario. With the way that we are running the car now and what we've learned, without the regen, you know, you're using a lot more brake. But the car just feels a lot more natural rolling through the corner without having that interference.
All right, Jordan, great to learn a little bit more about what is involved in running one of these cars at the racetrack. And obviously, as time goes by, more and more people are going to be doing that. You're still in the middle of competition here, so we wish you all the best for the rest of the day and look forward to seeing your results. Thanks for your time.
Awesome. I appreciate it. Thank you, guys.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.